Good morning, and can I welcome everyone to the 23rd meeting of 2020 of the Social Security Committee. We've got a full house this morning. No apologies have been received, and we move to agenda item one, decision to take an item in private. The committee is asked to agree that item five, consideration of evidence heard today, and item six, letter from the Finance and Constitution Committee, and in due course, the committee's response, are taken in private. I'll assume everyone agrees unless I see otherwise in the chat box. I'll just give a few moments there. Okay, that is agreed. And we move to agenda item two, COVID-19 and Social Security. And this is the committee's third evidence session of its inquiry on the role of Social Security in a response to and recovery from COVID-19. And can I welcome Morag Green, Strategic Lead Social Justice, Citizens Advice Scotland, Kirsty McKechnie, Welfare Rights Worker, Child Poverty Action Group in Scotland, and Katie Schmucker, Deputy Director of Policy and Partnership, Joseph Rowntree Foundation. Can I welcome all three of you this morning? Can I remind everyone where they can to keep their questions as focused and succinct as possible? And likewise for the answers. Now, also, can I indicate to witnesses that if you wish to respond to an answer to a question, rather, can you please put an R in the chat box? I would find that very helpful, just in case there's a lot of duplication with answers. Maybe someone's already covered that point. That would be quite helpful as well for the management of the meeting. So we'll now move to questions, and the first question is from our Deputy Convener, Polly McNeill, MSP.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. So my question is under the banner of the need for radical change in social security. So we've had a number of written submissions, and the two I want to mention is the Scottish Women's Budget Group, who said that COVID-19 and related economic crisis has shown us how quickly individual situations can change, and in turn the importance of having a responsive, flexible social security that supports people in their times of change. And similarly, Reform Scotland advocate radical change, where they say that really the system was broken before we had COVID-19, and putting sticking plasters on the current system won't help. And they say that now would be an ideal time to harness unparalleled change, where a juncture not dissimilar to the end of World War II and the creation of the NHS. So I'm interested in the panel's view on that. Just to add one thing, Convener, I've been following this line of questioning, which is one change that I think is needed to social security is many homeowners who have been working perhaps for most of their lives get nothing now for mortgage support out of social security. So they're one group, to me, that should be considered. But anything else the panel would like to add, I'd be grateful for. Thank you, Convener.
Okay. Now, I had indicated that witnesses could put an R in the chat function, but given it's the opening question, I think we'll put all three witnesses in at this point. But after that, please do put an R in the chat box. Can we start with Morag Green?
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. Thanks for the question. I think one thing that we've seen in our data throughout the pandemic is the breadth and depth of the financial impact that this is having across society. We're seeing new types of people come to CAB seeking advice on benefits. So what we know is that our new clients during the pandemic are more likely to be younger, they're more likely to be owner-occupiers, and they're more likely to be in employment than clients from before the pandemic. We know that one in four of our new CAB clients seeking advice on universal credit are homeowners who will receive no support with their housing costs for the first 39 weeks. Those concerns are very kind of live to us. And I think this is a good opportunity for considering long-term change to the system. But I think we also need to remember that lots of people are in financial crisis at the moment, and we can't also forget that we also need to be looking at mechanisms for getting money into the pockets of people who need it now. So our view is that in the kind of recovery process, we need to look at how we ensure that Social Security is paid at an adequate level. At the very least, it needs to be a safety net to prevent people falling into destitution, but ideally it would allow people to participate in society and live their lives with dignity. And I think the reliance that we've seen on food banks and other charitable support in our advice sessions throughout the pandemic indicate that levels of Social Security are currently insufficient for that. And I think that as we see that new demographic and homeowners and people who have perhaps kind of higher incomes going on to universal credit, they're going to experience a real income shock because of the difference between their current income and the levels of universal credit. So one of the things that we've talked about is a minimum income guarantee, which would be an income level that no one would be allowed to fall below in terms of their income, both from work and benefits. And we've had an opportunity to explore that with other kind of charities in recent weeks through the social renewal work that Scottish Government's been doing. And while Scottish Government doesn't have the kind of full levers to deliver that sort of scheme at the moment, we think that it's worth both putting pressure on the UK government to look at the levels of universal credit and critically to maintain the £20 uplift in universal credit, but also to look at what mechanisms are available to the Scottish Government in terms of the top-up benefits like Scottish Child Payment and uprating of existing payments, for example.
Hey, Kirsty McKechnie.
Thank you, Convener. Yeah, we would agree with a lot of what Morag has said there. Even before the pandemic, one in four children in Scotland were growing up in poverty. And COVID has highlighted the inadequacy of social security and the gaps in support. A lot of these problems were there before the pandemic, and that it simply eliminated the holes that were already there just by the sheer number of people who are facing them. As Morag said, in looking at radical change, we mustn't lose sight of what needs to be done just now for families who need financial support at the moment. In May, research by IPPPR and Standard Life found that almost half of households with children were all facing serious financial difficulties, compared with one third of all households, which highlights that families are being particularly hard hit by all of this. As Morag says, we need to look at the adequacy of the social security system, so that it does provide a really good safety net. But also we need to look at how reliable the social security system is. And at the moment, one of the things that comes through our early warning system evidence is how difficult it can be to interact with the social security system and some of the problems that can arise through errors. And that's something that would need to be addressed as well. Thank you.
Katie, do you want to respond as well?
Thank you, Convener. I mean, I would just add, I agree with a lot of what my colleagues have said. We came into this pandemic in pretty bad shape. We had 1 million people in Scotland who were experiencing poverty, a quarter of them children. We weren't on course to meet the interim child poverty targets. That says a lot about the way in which our social security system is not providing the anchor that we all think it should when we hit times of trouble. But I think there's real cause for hope here as well, because what recent months have shown us is that there is real public demand and cross-party support for us to find a clear strategy to solve poverty in the UK. You know, just think about the response that we've seen to, say, the Marcus Rashford campaign around free school meals. There is real energy behind these issues and demand that, you know, it's not okay that our social security safety net is not providing that sort of lifeline that people need. You know, we saw some very bold and compassionate action early on in this pandemic when the government chose to throw a lifeline to people on universal credit by increasing the standard allowance. That was the right thing to do then. And it's the right thing to do now to make that a permanent feature of our social security system. Because what the government recognised really quickly is that the help available was not enough to support people to meet their needs. That was true then, and it's still true now. So there are definitely some big issues around adequacy that we need to address. I think there are some really interesting ideas around minimum income guarantees and those sorts of things that my colleagues have talked about. And I think, you know, what those ideas share is a desire to make sure that our social security system is that anchor that people can rely on. And you know, those are ideas that we should absolutely explore. But I do think that we cannot overlook the need for fast action and fast fixes now. We are in the middle of a really, really difficult winter as the coronavirus storm continues. We need to make sure that people are not being swept into poverty, and that means using all the levers that are available to us now, like sort of speeding up some of the top-up payments that others have mentioned, like using new mechanisms that are already there to put money in people's pockets now, and to make sure that we get through this winter without more people being swept into poverty.
Pauline, do you want to follow up on some of that?
Just one question, convener. Do any of you have a figure in mind? Has any work been done about what a minimum income guarantee would look like? If you haven't, that's fine, but just if you had that figure, it would be interesting.
The awkward silences and waiting to see if witnesses are going to use the chat box to request to speak.
Well, Rag, you mentioned it first. Do you have any...
We don't have a figure. There are various figures that have been produced by different organisations. Citizens Advice Scotland doesn't have our own one, and I think that probably it's something that would need to be reviewed before that was taken forward as a policy.
Thank you.
I see Kirsty McKechnie. Yeah.
Thank you. In reaching a figure, we just want to proceed with caution to make sure that any figure that is reached takes into consideration different needs that different households may have, so that one simple figure would not suit all. And so it's really important that we recognise the additional cost of children, additional cost of disabilities, that it's just, it couldn't be one forward, straightforward figure. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Okay, thanks, Pauline. Tom Arthur.
Thank you, convener, and a good morning to the panel. One of the issues that's emerged over the last 7 or 8 months is the interaction between devolved and reserved competencies. If we look at the public health response to COVID, such as restrictions on the economy and indeed lockdown, well, that's a public health measure that is within the competence of the Scottish Parliament. To actually practically implement it, it requires a furlough scheme, which is obviously at the hands of the UK government. So there's clearly an interaction there where we have what we may have what we could call nominal competence, but in practice we rely upon decisions taken elsewhere. And I was picking up to pick up on a comment that Morag Green made with reference to not having the full levers and the need to put pressure on the UK government. I know we're going to look at some of the nuts and bolts of the response in the immediate term over the winter, but thinking towards recovery and around this theme of the need for radical change, I wonder what our panellists' reflections are on the current composition and balance of powers between Holyrood and Westminster for vis-à-vis social security. What lessons have been learned around that area, and what reflections our panellists have after the last 7 or 8 months? Do we have the balance right? Is there a need for adjustment? And also, along with that, if there's any reflections upon the fiscal levers that the Scottish Government has to respond effectively when there's an increased need for social security? And maybe if we start off with Morag.
So we don't have a view on where the powers necessarily lie. It's kind of complex field, and as you'll be aware, there are people in Scotland are able to kind of access social security payments from 4 different agencies. That's the UK government, Scottish government, DWP, HMRC, and local authorities. So it's a kind of complex field for people, and we would stress the importance in that of the provision of good quality advice to support people to navigate that. I think the other thing that has struck me in recent months is the challenge of the kind of cooperation between Scottish Government and DWP, because we're aware, for example, that the payment of the Scottish Child Payment to children over the age of 6 has been delayed by issues around data sharing between those 2 agencies. So I have a question in my mind about whether those agencies are both adequately resourced to do that kind of collaborative work and to make sure that, for example, DWP is able to kind of provide the services that the agency needs in order to deliver benefits efficiently.
Kirsty, would you like to comment?
Yes, thank you. I think we would agree with everything that Morag has said. Likewise, we have no position on where the powers should lie, so long as that they are used to their maximum impact. One of the things that we said in our submission was in the development of social security in Scotland. We wondered in future if social security would consider, rather than linking to devolved but to reserved benefits, moving away from linking to reserved benefits in order to preserve more autonomy for the Scottish Government, so that the Scottish Government have fuller control over social security in Scotland. I think that there are things that Scottish Government can do within their own powers just now, and it's important that those are used to their maximum efficiency just now as well. Thank you.
On that point, Kirsty, because you anticipated my next question around efficiency, do you think the current landscape of HMRC, DWP, Local Government and Social Security Scotland across four agencies, do you think that's the most efficient way in which to deliver social security?
Obviously, we have concerns about that from the client's perspective, that to the client it doesn't matter who delivers their benefits so long as they get it. But as Morag highlighted, there's then becomes issues of data sharing. Unless that data sharing is smooth, then it is an issue of having the benefits administered by different agencies.
Is there any reflections you have upon how we could optimise efficiency of data sharing across the four agencies?
I'm not an expert in data sharing, but I think that there needs to be an agreement that the data can be shared seamlessly. So that it's almost invisible to the client, so that there's no wrong door. If a client approaches one agency, then information should be passed to the other agencies. We would be looking at it very much from the client's point of view, and what happens behind the screens is probably better reserved for experts in data sharing.
But they're still very helpful. Katie, do you have any reflections upon what we've been discussing?
Well, I agree with much of what my colleagues have said, so I won't just repeat those. So I'll take us into a slightly different place. You mentioned the fiscal levers more broadly, and I think that is a really important question. I mean, Social Security clearly has a huge contribution to make in terms of reducing poverty, but it is not the only lever. And, you know, we have to be thinking about how we support people to retrain in a changing labour market. We have to be thinking about how we can bring down the cost of housing by continuing with the ambitions around building more affordable and social housing. And I think the borrowing powers of the Scottish Parliament are a challenge there in some of those areas. And I think that's something that I would highlight as an area where there maybe is a need to look again. Like my colleagues, I don't come with a prior view about the balance of social security, what's devolved and what's reserved. However, I would say that this point about integration is so important. When we talk to people with lived experience of poverty, the message we hear loud and clear time and time again is how complex the landscape is, how difficult to navigate it is for them, and how they find it very difficult to get all the information that they need about what not only what they're entitled to, but also what additional help they might be able to get through discretionary payments. And often, particularly on the discretionary payments, information comes through word of mouth or it comes through support from third sector organisations. I suspect these are issues we may come on to, so I'll leave it at that just now. But I think that point about integration and making sure it's easy for people to find out everything that they are entitled to in one go is just absolutely essential.
And finally, I would just like to ask each of our panellists in turn, and we'll maybe just stick with Katie for just now, and just very briefly in a few words, if there was one single radical change you could see implemented to social security in Scotland and you only had to click your fingers and it would happen, what would it be? Not to put you on the spot.
Yeah. I do think that Scotland has made absolutely the right choice with the child payment. I think that has the real potential to be a game changer. We have argued that if the child poverty targets are the number one priority, then the child payment is absolutely the right choice in terms of instrument. I think what I would want to see is a real amping up of the ambition around that. In particular, the thing I would highlight right now is the need for speed, basically. People cannot wait the amount of time that we are currently asking them to wait to get that help. You know, the need is now, and we think there are mechanisms that can be put in place to create a bridge to get cash in people's pockets quickly so that they're not having to wait, with the over sixes not having to wait until the end of 2022 to get help. So I think that sort of targeted support at low income, low income children, in order to meet a very clear goal around child poverty, I think that is absolutely right.
Kirsty?
I much agree with what Katie has just said. Increase the value of the Scottish Child Payment, bridge the gap until it can be rolled out to over sixes, possibly through school clothing grant, and consider uprating the Scottish Child Payment in 2021 rather than 2022, on the basis that we know that it's families that have been particularly hard hit, and that this is one mechanism that the Scottish Government has that has used so brilliantly to bring it in already. And let's be ambitious and make sure that it's having the impact that we want it to have now.
Thank you, Kirsty. And finally, Morag, one single radical change.
On a similar theme to what the other panellists have said, I would say more money in the system. And it may be that Scottish Government wants to look at a human rights budgeting approach to their budget, which we believe would end up with prioritisation of social security, and would put more money into that system in order to kind of to boost the money that's in people's pockets, because we see social security very much as an investment in people, and we think that in the current context, more money spent on social security is a good thing.
Thank you very much, Morag. No further questions, convener.
Thank you, Tom. So moving on to the next theme, when we're looking at the response so far by the UK and Scottish governments, it's maybe worth noting at this point that some of those final comments that are reflected in our letter as a committee to the Cabinet Secretary for Social Security, Shirley-Ann Somerville, as part of our budget scrutiny process. Something that was also mentioned earlier about making sure that claimants know exactly what they're entitled to, it may also be worth putting on the record that within our budget letter to the Cabinet Secretary, we highlighted a benefits uptake inquiry the committee previously did, which was calling for I don't think they used the expression, but almost like a One Scotland approach to benefits uptake, where the Scottish and the UK governments would come together, both with a statutory duty to maximise benefit uptake, and that Social Security Scotland would take a lead on that, so almost like a very focused benefits uptake strategy. So I think the committee's echoing some of the comments that have been made already. But also contained within that letter, here comes the substantive question, I suppose, as the committee said, that we would like to see an extension, a permanency to that £20 increase for universal credit claimants and for working tax credits as well. But I suppose my substantive question on this is that something sticks in my craw a little bit in relation to that. It's absolutely the right thing to do, but a constituent of mine who this time last year had an income shock and had to navigate their way through universal credit would have desperately wanted that £20 increase in benefit levels. So I suppose my question is, even if COVID had not occurred, and it's devastating communities right now, we know that, would increasing universal credit by £20 per week be the right thing to do anyway? And that's easy to say yes to that, of course, and I suspect witnesses will do that. But what I really want to know is, can you quantify what difference that will make to families, or is making to families currently? And can we maybe take Kirsty McKechnie in first on that?
Yeah, thank you. Convener, yes, absolutely. We have seen that the GRF have estimated that if the £20 uplift is removed, it will plunge a further 300,000 children into poverty across the UK. So that's in terms of the overall figures. But in terms of individual families, having this additional money is absolutely essential at the moment as families face additional costs. They're in the house more, they've got additional heating costs, there might be additional food costs from having children at home more, and the need to have children outside more. It requires warm clothing. But this £20 uplift cannot be underestimated in what a difference it's making to family, to individual families. Thank you.
That's really important because that provides balance, because what we're doing is we're welcoming an action that's been taken by the UK government, but what we're hopefully seeing is this is making a real difference and this has to endure in a kind of permanent fashion going forward. Katie, could you maybe reflect on some of that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that's absolutely right, and great take as to using our figures there. So I think just to come at it from a slightly different angle, I mean, we absolutely think that families should be kept afloat by retaining that £20 uplift in universal credit and working tax credit. We would actually go further and say that that same lifeline needs to be thrown to those who are on legacy benefits. Many of those people are disabled people, they are people who are sick. They need that help just as much as people on universal credit do. And I think, you know, the fact that the government acted so quickly when the pandemic struck, it was recognition of the fact that the current inadequacy of the support that's available through Social Security for people to meet their needs. You know, it was the right decision then, it's the right decision now to make that uplift permanent feature of the benefits system.
Thank you.
We'll lose, by taking it away at this point, we're going to see families losing £1,000 a year. Yeah, that's over 1 million working age people in Scotland that are set to lose that from their income. And yeah, that is simply something that is going to make an already incredibly challenging winter more difficult for those families. It would be the wrong thing to do. And actually, the only other thing I would add is just in terms of extending that lifeline to those on legacy benefits, this is the month now where that decision needs to be made, because it takes time to work that into the system to get it operational for the new financial year. So we are really pressing hard now for the UK government to not only to announce that it's going to make the change to UC permanent, that it will extend that lifeline to those on legacy benefits as well.
I think that's very helpful, and I should note the committee reflected that in our budget letter also. Maura Green, just before I bring you in, is there also a danger that if ultimately this £20 per week increase, which is very, very welcome, eventually goes, does it send out a message to those who have felt isolated and struggling on benefits before COVID-19, that once we mop up eventually the crisis, the economic crisis and impact of COVID-19 for those who don't normally interact with the benefit system, and they hopefully move out of the benefit system again, that we're saying to other people who are in poverty that they are somehow less deserving than those who are new recipients of universal credit and legacy benefits? Is there a stigma issue here if we don't make this £20 per week permanent?
I think that's certainly a risk, because Citizens Advice Scotland has had long standing concerns about the level of universal credit. We don't think it's paid at an adequate level prior to the pandemic, and that's before you take into consideration things like deductions and the advanced payment, which automatically puts people into debt as they enter the system. So yes, I think that regardless of the pandemic, the level of universal credit was too low. We did some analysis of our complex debt clients over the summer, which showed that without the additional £20 a week, 8 in 10 of those people who were on universal credit were in a negative budget, which meant they were unable to meet their essential living costs. And that additional £20 a week had the effect of lifting 1 in 5 of those people out of a negative budget. So still a significant number of people on universal credit in complex debt on a negative budget. So I think that illustrates the fact that the level of the payment with or without the £20 a week is insufficient to cover many people's essential living costs. It's absolutely critical that it is extended. And I would just echo Katie's point about the importance of the UK government making a decision to do that as soon as possible, because every day in Citizens Advice Bureau, our advisors are speaking to people about their benefits and people on legacy benefits who are thinking about moving on to universal credit to take advantage of that universal credit uplift. because it may look like they're better off in the short term, but it's quite a complex decision to make because they don't know at the moment whether or not that £20 uplift will continue beyond April. So it's a difficult decision, and we are concerned that some people will move on to universal credit for that kind of short-term benefit, and then it'll be taken away from them and they'll be worse off on universal credit than they were on legacy benefits. So it's absolutely critical to assist people's decision-making that decision is made as soon as possible.
That's helpful, Morag. That also sounds a little bit like the extension of furlough debate that was happening recently, which again, we all welcome that was extended, but we know some employers went ahead, consulted redundancy and implemented redundancies and even restructured businesses. And therefore, the welcome extension was seen as being too late for some. So on the time-sensitive nature of any extension of the £20 per week universal credit uplift, are we talking about confirmation, of course, as soon as possible? Are we talking before Christmas? Are we talking before the end of January? You seem to be suggesting there's like a window that's closing by which the UK government can actually confirm the £20 will be made permanent, or else it won't work as well as it otherwise could do, and there could be unintended consequences. What's the timescale around that, do you think?
I think as soon as possible. I think that I think it's slightly different with the furlough scheme because people will continue to kind of receive something regardless of their situation. I think the challenge at the moment is for individuals making a decision about whether or not they're better off on legacy benefits or on universal credit, and the uncertainty about what the levels of universal credit beyond the end of March introduce an element of risk for them. So yeah, we would like to see a decision on the extension within as soon as possible. It's absolutely critical because it's impacting upon people's decisions just now.
Okay, that's helpful. And just before I move on to Rachel Hamilton, who's going to continue on this theme, want to give you the opportunity. There's been other changes that's been made by the UK government, which again have been welcomed, including in relation to the minimum income floor and restoring the link between the local housing allowance and current local rents, whether some of those should be made permanent or extended. So what else has the UK government done which has been welcome, and which ones do you think should be extended or made permanent? Perhaps if there's agreement on this, we might only need to take one witness in. I'm just checking my chat box. Is there anyone want to volunteer to come in this particular point? Well, my apologies then for picking Katie Schmucker to come in relation to this one. Katie, could you have some observations on this? What else would you want permanent? What has worked well? What should we stick with?
So I think the two that you mentioned are really important. The suspension of the minimum income floor, I think, speaks to the fact that the self-employed elements of universal credit are not functioning that well for self-employed people. And there is a need to look again at how we do that. So I don't think we can just suspend the minimum income floor in perpetuity, but I think it does speak to the need to look again at how universal credit treats self-employed people. Local housing allowance, which you mentioned, the restoration of that to 30% is absolutely crucial. We were seeing a growing gap between people's housing costs on the one hand and the support they were getting through the benefits system for their housing costs on the other, which meant they were having to dip into their other not very substantial income in order to be able to bridge that gap. And we were seeing more and more, 30,000 children in Scotland are driven into poverty purely as a result of their housing costs. So, it's really having an impact. So the restoration of the 30% is really welcome. What we need to see now, though, is for that to be uprated in line with rising rents rather than just general inflation. So I think there's a big uprating question on the horizon, but we certainly welcome the restoration of the 30%. And the fact that it looks like that is a change that is going to be staying as well.
And are there any other technical changes? Because quite often there can be things that appear like minor technical changes but can make a real and substantive difference to claimants. Is there anything else that witnesses want to mention that's been welcome that you would like to see either extended or made permanent? Don't feel obliged to come in. It's just the opportunity to put on the record now if there is something. Okay, we'll move on. Rachel Hamilton.
Fiona, it doesn't give me much confidence that perhaps there is going to be something else that is going to be answered in my question, but I just wondered, with regards to the measures of the devolved social security measures that have been put in place, such as discretionary housing payments, extra money for that, or the Scottish Welfare Fund, or indeed extending carers allowance. I mean, how significant have these extra payments been? And do you believe that they should be permanent, is my question. And shall I go to Kirsty?
Thank you. Yes, these increases in funding for local authorities are very welcome. One of the things that we would like to see alongside the increases is clear and transparent guidance about how that money should be directed. I think that that's one of the things that would improve the way that that money is spent, and the way to make sure that it is targeted in a way that it does hit the people who need that money the most at the moment. I think in relation to the discretionary housing payments, one of the things that we saw during lockdown was that people were facing a delay in moving and were left with a dual rent liability where they had to pay the rent in two homes. Housing associations felt that they couldn't move the date of the people were allowed to move in, and felt that discretionary housing payments should be picking that up, but discretionary housing payments weren't necessarily picking that up. So it's very clear direction from Scottish Government about how do they want this money to be spent, and how do they want it to be targeted. It would be really helpful, not just for local authorities, but also for people who are advising individuals as well. Thank you.
Okay, Katie.
So certainly, the as Kirsty says, the increased funding is really welcome. I mean, I think both the measures that you mentioned, DHPs and the Scottish Welfare Fund, they are discretionary spend that enables a really important crisis response. So I don't think we would necessarily expect to see funding continue at the very high level that it is now, but I do think there are big questions about whether the funding that is in now for the crisis is sufficient, and whether it is meeting the need that's there. So to take DHPs, for example, we know that one of the really big challenges is that people's arrears are climbing. We did a big survey, a big poll recently, which found about 10% of renters already are in arrears. The protections in place are great, they're really important. But if we don't act on arrears, we may well see a wave of evictions coming in the spring when some of those protections are lifted. So I think we would certainly be asking whether we should be doing more through DHPs for targeted support around arrears. And as Kirsty said, that requires some changes to the guidance to enable that to happen. Again, with the Scottish Welfare Fund, it plays a really important role of crisis response. The extra funding that's gone into it is really important and really welcome, but we have concerns about how well that is operating. And again, would like to see some minimum standards set out in the guidance that actually means that we see a greater consistency in terms of what sort of situations people are able to get help in, and also how well the fund is marketed and communicated around. There's an awful lot of really complex language. A lot of people don't know that it exists. They don't know that they might be able to get help through it. Again, people need help now. They need cash in their pockets now. So it's great that the money's going in. It doesn't necessarily need to be permanently funded at that level when we're not in a time of crisis. But while we are in a time of crisis, we need to make sure that that help is going where it's needed.
Before I bring Morag in, I think, Katie, you were just speaking there to the issues that people have in accessing, the Scottish Welfare Fund or crisis grants, and actually the way that we give people access to those funds. Now, I mean, I don't know if you have any suggestions as to how it would be better delivered, because obviously some local authorities, the default mechanism was really just an online application, and we've heard in past evidence that that has held people back, and they have not, even though they've been eligible for grants, they have not been able to take those grants up and have had to turn to charity. I just wondered if you could comment really for the record how you believe that it could be improved.
I mean my reflection would be that it's not always very well, this varies obviously between places, but in some places it's badly promoted, the complex language that's used to talk about it puts people off, doesn't help them to realise that they are potentially able to get help through those mechanisms. And, you know, I think one of the things I would also highlight as a concern is that whilst the funding for grants increased substantially, the administrative funding didn't increase alongside. So I think there were real challenges for local authorities in actually trying to administer the funds and get the money out the door. But I mean, the fact that we've seen third sector emergency support funds like Arbalawa's, seeing huge demand, huge increase in grant funding through the third sector, emergency grant funding through the third sector, does suggest that, because we haven't seen that same increase around Scottish Welfare Fund, does suggest that something's not working well there. I mean, I would want to see some minimum standards around, I'm a commissioner for the Scottish Poverty and Inequality Commission, as well as an employee of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation. And the commission has done some, I think, really good work on the Scottish Welfare Fund. And it talks about the need for there to be minimum standards around eligibility, around the way in which the funds are promoted, around ease of applications, speaking to that point that you just raised about online only, and also the way in which staff are trained to be able to deliver it and to be able to live up to those the aspiration of a system that is imbued with dignity and respect. It's really welcome that that's going to be sort of pushed down through the system to the local authority level, and that's going to need some training of staff to get that kind of consistency of approach across all different local authorities.
Thank you. Morag?
Yes, so first of all, I'm just going to quickly cover off some of the things that I would like to see kind of changed with the system generally, because I had a technical issue when that question was asked, but I think it links into your question as well. And things that we would like to see continue beyond the pandemic are relaxation of conditionality, because we've seen that, or the word from our advisors is that's having a positive impact for people and their experience of universal credit. There's been greater flexibility for phone applications and maintenance of universal credit claims, and that's had a positive impact in Scotland, where historically the digital by default nature of universal credit has been more problematic perhaps than it's been in other parts of the UK because of rurality and issues with mobile phone signals and distance to job centres or to a public internet site. And the other thing that I would stress is on phone assessments for the disability payments. Initially, we were pleased that DWP had moved away from face-to-face assessments, but what we're hearing is that the phone assessments are actually very arduous for people. They're very long, and they often don't have the support that they would normally have for a face-to-face assessment. So we would caution against placing too much emphasis on that as something that could learn from the Scottish system. But those issues around the kind of phone applications for universal credit are also very relevant to Scottish Welfare Fund. We know that in some areas there is a digital-only application process for Scottish Welfare Fund, and we believe that that presents an access issue for many people. So we would like to see going forward all local authorities offering a range of ways to access Scottish Welfare Fund and that kind of no wrong door principle that we've talked about elsewhere, a sort of multi-channel approach, as it were. And I think that I would agree with much of what Katie and Kirsty have already said about the importance of the Scottish Welfare Fund. We've seen demand for advice on the fund, on accessing the fund throughout the pandemic. So we believe that the investment has been really important. We are concerned that the money is not necessarily always getting spent as effectively as it could be, but I would echo the point that's been made about the administration and the lack of funds that Scottish local authorities have had for the administration of the fund. And if the Programme for Government aspiration to deliver a human rights-based approach to social security at local authority level is to be realised. We really think that that's going to require some support, additional support for local authorities to do that. And the other point that I would make that's not already made is that I think it's important that those the pots, both for DHPs and Scottish Welfare Fund, are topped up as necessary, because we're concerned that local authorities are not spending the money at point of need because they're concerned about running out of money before the end of the financial year. But I think during this crisis situation, it's really important that those funds are kept topped up. And I think, as Katie has said, for DHPs, we see that as being increasingly important, because we think there's a role for that in tackling the rent arrears problem and that we're seeing developing as well.
Thank you, Convener. That's me.
Okay, thank you. We'll move to our next theme now, and Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Convener. I think it's fair to say that in this important discussion, many of the themes are overarching. So some of what I was intending exploring has been touched upon, but I suppose, you know, I've got a real concern about those who fall through the gaps in, like many other MSPs, I've had a lot of constituents who've been in touch because they didn't qualify either for the job retention scheme or the self-employment scheme, and some wouldn't have been able to claim means-tested benefits either. And, you know, we're told in our briefing for this morning's discussion that research from Welfare at a Social Distance Project estimates that across the UK, over 200,000 people who claimed for universal credit were, you know, were advised that they were ineligible. And, you know, obviously that can be very difficult to hear, and that could be perhaps because it was deemed they had, you know, enough savings or whatever, but it doesn't take away from the fact that many folk have experienced great financial stress, and nearly half of it have, you know, reported severe financial strain. Now, we've been having a discussion about the gaps that exist, and also the fact that some folk are coming up against the hard reality of the inadequacy of some payments. And, you know, I know Pauline McNeill has spoken, and I wholly support a minimum income guarantee. Obviously, Reform Scotland and others, you know, are getting behind my own party's long-standing policy for a universal basic income. But what can we do in the meantime? Because I'm sure you share my concerns that we don't want to exacerbate a situation and come out at the end of this and find people in truly dire straits through no fault of their own.
Kirsty McKechnie, perhaps you could start off on this.
Thank you. I mean, I think we wholeheartedly agree that we've identified a number of gaps in social security support during the pandemic. I think the ones that we particularly identified were students who would normally have a part-time job or a casual type work to see them through, who are, if they don't have dependents or disabilities, are not entitled to universal credit. So if they're not working, there's then that great loss of income. A particular issue for migrants who may either be EU nationals who are not entitled to benefits because they're not working, or because they have no recourse to public funds. And then 16 to 17 year olds who are not entitled to universal credit because they're not yet 18, and yet there's a big issue in their household. I think we need to look at these gaps and look at how can we support people who are in these situations. And it's not just that there's gaps in the system, but there's also inadequacy in the system. So things like the arbitrary limits that have been placed in Social Security, like the benefit cap and two-child limit, either looking at removing them, and if they cannot be removed, how do we mitigate them in the meantime? I think that's probably the main things from us just now.
Thank you.
Katie, do you want to come in?
Yeah, I mean, I think Kirsty has identified some of the really important and glaring gaps. So I think the only thing I would add is, I think the experience that you point to that the Welfare from a Social Distance Project has identified is actually the problem that we have with contributory benefits. You know, a lot of those people who are finding they're not eligible for universal credit will be because they either have savings in excess of the savings limit, or they have perhaps have a partner who's working and that takes them over the income limit. But that is not to say that they are not experiencing a very significant income shock. That is not to say that they are not going to be struggling to keep up with payments you know, for rent, for their bills that were perfectly manageable when they were, you know, when they had two earners in the household and circumstances have changed. In that scenario, people would expect the contributory benefit system to kick in to be able to get that bit of support for, you know, for a limited amount of time to get them through that experience. But I think what people are finding, and actually it's a sort of, you know, when you think again about this sort of application of the £20 lifeline to universal credit, but not to other benefits, we're actually in a situation now where universal credit is slightly more generous than contributory benefits. And I think that is an odd situation to have got ourselves into. So I think it raises really big questions about sort of how we design the contributory element of our benefits system.
Maura Green?
Yeah, I would agree with everything that's been said so far, but I would add a couple of other kind of gaps that we've identified. And I think despite the kind of various schemes that were in place for self-employed people, we've seen self-employed people fall through the gaps, both because they weren't entitled to either of the payments from the UK or the Scottish Government, and also because they lack kind of protections that workers have, like sick pay, for example. So for self-employed people who couldn't work because they were self-isolating, that protection wasn't in place. So I think there's a need to look at what income protection is available for self-employed people. And I think that the sick pay, levels of sick pay overall, I think the current pandemic has highlighted the kind of inadequacy of that. And the other gap that I would like to flag up is around people that are on 0 hours contracts, who very often have been unable to access the furlough scheme. And I think one of the furlough scheme has been very welcome and has kept lots of people attached to jobs and with an income coming into their homes. But there have been some gaps in it. And one of the issues that we've seen with it is there's no right to access it. It's dependent upon your employer facilitating it. So we've seen lots of people who were denied access to it because their employer didn't access it for whatever reason. But we've also seen people that have, on 0 hours contracts in particular, who haven't been able to kind of take advantage of that protection. So I think the kind of rights and protections of 0 hours workers and people in the gig economy is something that we need to look at, and how the social security system interacts with them going forward.
Alison?
Yeah, thank you. I really appreciate the comments you've made. I've been looking at, you know, what happens in other countries. For, you know, in Denmark, for instance, unemployment insurance can pay up to 90% of the previous salary, albeit up to ceiling. And I've been having a look at the German, is it Kurzarbeit system, which is also of interest. But these things don't really apply if you are in such precarious work that you've got no guaranteed hours and, you know, practically no contract anyway. So it seems to me what all our contributors, witnesses this morning are saying, that the impact of coronavirus has absolutely strengthened the case for higher benefit rates. But I'd be grateful if you could comment on that, but also on the self-isolation support grant that you brought up there, Morag. I think there have been a number of concerns raised in relation to that. And I think it was Richard Geis from Rights Advice Scotland who told us last week that a high proportion of applications have been rejected. You know, I think there are concerns there around means testing. So do you think these grants, you know, that particular grant, I mean, it is the case that we're struggling with compliance with self-isolation. Would it be helpful if that grant moved, you know, it wasn't just available for employees, even if someone doesn't or is not able to work? Is there a case for making that grant available to them?
It's interesting that you raise this, because it's not something that we've seen a lot of feedback come back from the CAB on yet in terms of issues accessing it. I think one of the issues that we have picked up on is that the guidance around it is not terribly clear. And I think there's to the extent that there's potentially kind of contradictions in different official guidance that's been issued on it. And I think that's kind of particularly relevant around whether people with no recourse to public funds are able to access it, And it looks like from the mygov.scot website that they are not, because they're not entitled to any of the kind of passported benefits. But the guidance that was agreed by COSLAW and Scottish Government and was circulated to local authorities says that people with no recourse public funds who were in low paid work are entitled to access it. So I think as a first step, there's a need to make sure that the guidance on that payment is crystal clear. And I think that applies across the board for guidance. It's a real kind of barrier to take up of any social security payment if the eligibility is not clear. And to be honest, I don't have a view on whether or not it should be open to people who are not in work. It's something that I would need to look at. So sorry about that.
Thank you very much, Morag. Thank you. Appreciate that.
Was there, just before we move to our deputy convener, Paul McNeill, for some additional questions, does any other witness have a view on extending the criteria of the self-isolation grant? Kirsty McKechnie.
Thank you. We concur with what Morag said already about the need for the guidance on the self-isolation grant to be clearer. But one of the other things that we'd like to see being really clear is it says that if somebody doesn't meet the criteria for the self-isolation grant, that they, on mygov.uk, then consideration should be given to a crisis grant. And what we'd like to see happening at a local authority is if somebody has refused a self-isolation payment, as Richard Gass said last week, that was 75% in Glasgow were being refused, that automatically is then treated as a crisis grant, an application for a crisis grant, and that there is guidance around when it is particularly pertinent to pay that. So, for example, people who might not be entitled to the self-isolation payment, we don't know if the guidance, we haven't seen any guidance that suggests it's available to people who have to self-isolate more than once, and is it payable to parents who maybe have to take time off work because their children are self-isolating? We know that a number of children have been sent home from school. But the other thing we'd like to see really clearly is in relation to the crisis grants, if that is the case, that we know that Ms Somerville sent a letter to local authorities back in March advising that it should be possible to get the crisis grant more than three times a year. And yet through our advisors, we're hearing that crisis grants are still being refused on the basis that somebody's had three grants already in this year and that those exceptional circumstances aren't being taken on board. So I think what we really want to see is that if people don't meet the criteria for the self-isolation support payment, that there's a very clear route for them as to what other help is available and that that is a seamless transition for them.
Thank you.
Alison, can we move on now? Did you have anything else you wanted to add before we move on?
I suppose my one outstanding question this morning really would be about help for self-employed people, for those people who are still telling us that the support they need isn't in place. I mean, are we simply suggesting that, are we in a position where universal credit is our only response?
I just wonder if any of our witnesses want to say something specific on that, if you've got a specific suggestion on how we do better for the self-employed, feel free to put it on record just now, or you could email the committee, the clerk and team at a later date, we can deal with it as part of our inquiry. Does anyone want to comment on that just now? I've not seen any indication. Thank you for that point, Alison. It's now on the record. Can we move to Paula McNeill?
Just to agree with Alison Johnson on the last point that she made there, it just seems that there's a gap for the committee to look at in terms of universal credit being a response. Could I ask Kirsty, I was a bit astonished at the figure that you mentioned that 75% of people in Glasgow have been refused the isolation grant. Have you any idea why that might be?
I'm purely taking this from Richard Gass's contribution to the evidence session last week, but I think what he indicated was that he thought it was because people weren't entitled to the qualifying benefit. So, for example, universal credit or job seekers allowance, that was the reason that people were being refused it.
Yeah, thank you. It just seems to be a big issue for the committee to look at is qualifying benefit the stepping stone to something else of great need to a lot of people. So thanks for that. I only had one question. It was just to try and understand the self-isolation support grant, if anyone can help me. So for employees earning over £120 a week, then they would get statutory sick pay, which is £95, 85 pence. But for those in receipt of universal credit or legacy benefits, the new the grant is £500. I just wonder, maybe, is there a disparity between the two rates? So if you have to self-isolate for 2 weeks, then statutory sick pay would be the £95 times two. Or do you only get a proportion of the £500? Does that mean that there's a disparity between workers and statutory sick pay and those in receipt of universal credit? And I guess it's complicated by the fact that a lot of people working will also be on universal credit. And would that mean that they would get the lower amount or the 500 amount? If anyone can help me at all in answering that, I'd be very grateful. Thanks.
Any comments? I'm trying to give witness the chance to self-select who wants to make a comment on that. But Cathy McKechnie, I can see you're desperately keen to make a comment.
I'm not sure that was desperately keen that you were spotting there, but I will try. I think you're right. There is a disparity there, and it will come down to the individual circumstances. But it does in a household. But it does suggest that for people who are receiving a benefit, if they are then entitled to the £500 payment, that they will receive a more of a cushion, whereas there will be some people who just sit above the cliff edge in relation to benefits, who then might see a significant income drop. And as we do see that people tend to budget to their incomes, that could have a big impact on people's ability to meet their outgoings as well.
And do any of our other witnesses want to come in on that? Okay, I don't see a follow-up on that. Pauline, do you want to?
It was just asked, Kirsty, I wonder if you want to hazard a guess about this even. Would you think that people who are on the child tax credits, for example, that you're nominally in the universal credit system and you're working, would there be a choice there between that £500 or you're on the statutory sick pay? Or I appreciate you might not know the answer to that, but
I don't know the answer to that off the top of my head, but I'd be more than happy to come back to you on it.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Kira. Thank you, Kirsty.
Okay, thanks, Pauline. And we'll move to Keith Brown now.
Thanks, Convener. On the issue of Social Security Scotland benefits, there was a big increase in processing times for Best Start grant, which went from 11 working days to 20 working days in August. I think this is due, we're told, to something called telephony. I assume that's the number of people being able to staff phones and so on. I just wonder, in addition to some of the points which the panellists have already made, if they want to talk about the impact of COVID on the need for any changes to any Social Security Scotland benefits, whether in terms of administration, eligibility, level of payments, or support to access the payments. I know some of that has been covered in some of the responses so far, but anything in addition to what's already been said? And maybe Kirsty first.
I think obviously we've already covered what we'd like to see happening in relation to the Scottish Child Payment in response to the pandemic, that we'd like to see it increased. I have to say, through our early warning system evidence, we haven't heard of huge problems accessing Scottish Social Security during the pandemic, and I think that's to be commended. The other colleagues may have different evidence to that. I think that the main thing is in relation to the increase in the Scottish Child Payment and just making sure that the benefits remain accessible to people. I think other colleagues might want to come in on that.
All right, does anyone?
Yeah, I mean, our evidence base as well isn't showing any significant issues with Scottish payment, which is to their credit, and I think probably the kind of multi-channel approach that Scottish Government committed to early on, which means that people can apply online or via phone, or in different ways has served them well in the pandemic. I think that I've already touched upon the fact that we'd like to see the Scottish Child Payment increased. We also very much welcome the additional payment that was made to carers back in April, and we would like to see that repeated because we think that that has a very kind of good impact upon people. I think that's the main points I would make on that.
I don't know if Katie wants to come in at all.
Yes. So just to add a little detail to what I said previously, as I've said, we want faster action to support low-income families with children who need help now. And we really do think that waiting till the end of 2022 to roll out the payments for families with children aged 6 and over is simply too long to wait. We think that money could be that we could route money to those families by using local authority channels as a temporary fix. For example, the channels that local authorities have been using to make payments to people in lieu of free school meals during lockdown, or potentially the school clothing grant. They're two potential options that we could look at there. And we'd see that as a bridge to just as a stopgap to get us through to when the formal payment then comes on stream further down the line. Now, there is a trade-off to be made here. Doing this at speed will inevitably mean that you wouldn't be reaching as many people who would be eligible for the payment in the long run. But we think that actually, given the level of need now, that trade-off is one that is worth making, and we shouldn't allow perfection to be the enemy of the good here. We acknowledge that there'll be varied take-up across different local areas. We acknowledge that eligibility would be narrower, but we think it's a reasonable trade-off, and we estimate that you could potentially reach 178,000 children through that route, and it would cost around about £90 million, we think. So not insignificant, but relatively small cost in order to make a big difference to families of children who really need help as we kind of enter into this really challenging winter as we carry on with this storm of coronavirus that's hitting people's incomes.
Thanks very much for that. It's quite reassuring to hear the positive comments about access to Scottish Social Security benefits, and it may be that Mark Griffin wants to come in about that. But having had that reassurance, can I ask a more general question with the risk of the convener jumping all over me for doing so? And it's really about the previous comments that we made about occasionally we get reference to UBI and to minimum income guarantees. And just as Pauline McNeill's very pertinent question, what level do you set it at? There's no real answer to that for fairly obvious reasons. I just wonder if, because we always run into that difficulty when we look at UBI and minimum income guarantee, what you're trying to do, and different people have different needs. Should we not be looking at it from a needs-based approach? So everybody should have a warm, dry home. Everyone should have internet access in that home. Everyone should have the ability to heat and light the home and so on as well. And if you did that, you would have different packages. So somebody losing their job, that then their house was in jeopardy, would get support to sustain that house. Is it not better to try and look at it that way, what the needs of individuals are, and then the state fills in and supplies those needs, rather than trying to always find an arbitrary point of universal basic income, which might or might not be enough for those needs?
Yeah, I think Morag Green's indicated there might be a little bit of drift from theme four, but an important question nevertheless. Morag Green, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I think the other idea that's interesting that sits alongside UBI and minimum income guarantee is the universal basic services model, which is the principle that the state provides or funds a range of essential services for people in the community. And I think for us, the pandemic has highlighted really highlighted some of the services that should be considered essential. And I think broadband and internet connectivity is one. We knew about it before, but the lockdown and the working from home situation and the closure of public internet access points has really highlighted how important it is for people to have access to broadband as an essential service. And I think another one for us would be advice. It's critical that people have advice to deal with points of crisis in their life and to access the things that they are entitled to. It's central to a human rights-based approach, I think. And I think one thing that Cass would like to see going forward is a redefinition of what are statutory services. So what services are essential to our communities? And are they the same services that are currently defined in Scottish law as being statutory? And is there an opportunity at this moment to revisit that and in consultation with communities and voluntary sector and local authorities to think about what are the services that are essential to our communities? How do we define them? And can we kind of codify that in law to make sure that people have access to the things that they need in order to have a decent life?
Kirsty McKechnie wants to come in.
There are some things that would lend themselves really nicely to being a universal basic service, like Monag says, broadband. It's almost like we turn the tap on in the house, we get water. Every house should have broadband these days as well. But I think it's really important that we consider which services lend themselves nicely to this and that not all will do. It's important that people still have dignity, respect and autonomy to make choices. So, for example, in things like providing care, we want to make sure that people don't lose those things that are important to them, like the ability to make choices and autonomy to reflect their different needs of different households. So whilst we're in favour for some services, we would just add a note of caution for other services that it needs to be given careful consideration.
OK, Keith, we're going to have to move on, I'm afraid. And can we bring in Mark Griffin?
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to ask a question about access to social security entitlements in general through the pandemic. The image that we have, and it's probably a familiar picture for other MSPs, is people reaching a real crisis point, going to a local authority for stop shop, coming into an MSP's office, going to a job centre, essentially being really distressed and bearing their soul, and a skilled and experienced advice worker picking through that story and identifying what support they would be eligible for. Just how is that ability for someone to seek that sort of comprehensive advice and really dig through someone's story being impacted by the lack of access through the pandemic to local offices and face-to-face advice services?
Who'd like to go first on that?
I'm happy to go first, if that's helpful.
Thank you, Morag.
It's a really good question, and it's one that we've obviously been working on, given the nature of what Citizens Advice does. And there was a huge effort at the start of the pandemic to get our advisors kitted up so that they had laptops and phones at home so that we could continue to provide our advice service. And we did that with a great deal of success, and there was a real kind of switch in March from the overwhelming majority of our advice being given face-to-face in bureau to it happening from people's homes. What we're hearing from our advisors is that those phone calls are getting longer because, as always, they're dealing with a range of different issues. I think that's one of the kind of real benefits of Citizens Advice Bureau. You can come in with one problem and you get help with a range of other issues. So those calls are getting longer as the range of issues that people are facing become more complex. And also people are distressed quite often. They're dealing with people who are at point of crisis. So that is difficult. I think it's difficult for the people with the issues. It's also difficult for the advisors. And I think we've also been concerned throughout the pandemic about access to our services. And we know, for example, that kind of early on in the pandemic, there was a real kind of dip in the number of applications for disability benefits. So I suppose kind of initially you would think that a telephone application system would improve access for people who maybe have mobility problems, for example, but we saw that dip. So I think it's something that we need to be live to as social distancing goes on, is how do people who have access issues continue to access the services that they need that are essential to them.
Katie or Kirsty?
Yeah, I mean, I think that point about being able to access your entitlements is absolutely crucial. And, you know, I've touched on this before, but I think there's a lot of complexity in the system. And we know that complexity drives down take up, along with, you know, a lack of awareness of what you're entitled to, any costs associated with being able to claim, and the stigma of claiming as well. And I think it's the stigma that means that people are often waiting to the point of crisis before they seek help, which then means that, you know, some of the things you might be able to help with earlier on have already passed. So I think we need to do everything that we can to make the system as uncomplex as possible from the point of view of the person seeking help. That's not to say it won't be complex behind the scenes, of course it will be, but from the point of view of the person who needs help, it needs to be a single point of access, and being able to get all of the advice and information about everything you're entitled to all in one place. And yeah, we're seeing some really promising experiments, I think, with different ways of providing advice prior to the pandemic, whether that's through GP surgeries in Glasgow, or whether that's through schools, nurseries and libraries in Edinburgh. You know, there are really positive examples that we can learn from there and build on as and when those routes sort of open up again. So I think we need to think about not just about how we're delivering advice in the midst of crisis, and Ian Morag's talked very eloquently about that, but also going forward, how do we actually make sure that that advice is available to people in the longer term as well, in a way that is accessible and goes to where they are, and sort of interacts with them in their lives.
Kirsty, do you want to add anything?
One of the things that we've seen during the pandemic is that advice services have managed to turn themselves around really, really quickly in order to be able to support some people remotely. But one of the areas that we're finding that there's a real barrier being put in place, not by the advice agencies, but by DWP, is in relation to disability benefits. That we are hearing of people having assessments and asking for somebody to be allowed to support them, and then that barrier is being put in place to having somebody in the call with them. And then we also run into the problems of things like consent for advisors who are not necessarily sitting in the room with the person. And it's just really important that in recognising that access to the benefit system, that we make sure that the agencies that are delivering the benefits make it as easy as possible for people to utilise the support that may be available to them without placing barriers to that.
Thank you. I know we'll be returning to disability benefits before too long, so glad you mentioned that. Can we move on now, and it's Shola Robinson, MSP, please.
Good morning, everyone. We've touched on some of the issues I want to explore around local authority payments, and I'll try and avoid covering the areas that we've already covered. But the Scottish Welfare Fund, I know that you've looked at the previous evidence session, and you'll have seen, therefore, some concerns raised about the inconsistency of decision making by local authorities, whether the scope and the remit of the Welfare Fund needs to be reviewed in the light of what its original purpose was and what its purpose and use is now. So I guess the first question, maybe start with Morag, or yes, of what you ask the panel, really, what you think about that. Should it be reviewed, and what about the inconsistency of decision making at the moment?
I think that the guidance for Scottish Welfare Fund needs to be reviewed, and I think that that would help with the inconsistency of decision making, which is also something that we've seen through our evidence base as a barrier to access throughout the pandemic. So I think that is something that needs to be addressed. I'd also like to flag up the guidance for DHPs, which have never really been revised specifically for the Scottish context. And I think there's a need to look at that quite urgently. We would like to see DHPs being used as a protection for people in rent arrears, especially as emergency protections wind down, as they will have to at some point in the future. So we would like that support to be available to people in that situation and for local authorities to be clear that they can use it for that purpose. And I think just generally, there's with the kind of introduction of the self-isolation payment as well, there's local authorities in that kind of space that are being asked to do a lot of different things. So I think kind of clarity about the roles of those different funds and how they sit together and how they should be what the eligibility is would be absolutely welcomed and could help with those issues that we are seeing about access and inconsistency of decision making.
And I take it from what you're saying is that you would want to see that broadened rather than contracted in terms of the eligibility criteria, and the use would be the thrust of what you're saying.
I wouldn't necessarily say that the eligibility needs to be made more narrow. I think it needs to be made crystal clear so that everybody understands what the entitlements are, because as I've said already, without that crystal clear guidance, that in itself is a barrier to access. And it also makes the jobs of advice agencies like ourselves and CPAG very difficult if there's ambiguity about whether or not an individual is entitled to a payment.
Okay. Kirsty, do you have anything to add?
We would reiterate what Morag said in relation to the clear and transparent guidance. Yes, we would be delighted if there was a review of the Scottish Welfare Fund, just to ensure that it is working as efficiently as it could be. And we know that with 32 different local authorities, that means that there's 32 different IT systems. We know that there's different information on different local authority websites. Some will use eligibility checkers that might prevent people from applying for a crisis grant or a community care grant who might otherwise be entitled. And it's just these are sort of little barriers that can be put in place for take-up with it unintentionally sometimes. I mean, I think one of the websites we came across recently said that you could only apply if you were in receipt of an allowable benefit. And we know that the criteria is that you have to be in a low income, and we're not entirely sure what an allowable benefit is. So it's ensuring that there's consistency across, you know, no matter where you live in the country, that you get the same information and the same right of access to the Scottish Welfare Fund and to discretionary housing payments. And we would absolutely reiterate what Morag said in relation to the DHP guidance. We know that that is causing issues in some local authorities who have perhaps noted that the existing good practice guide is directed at England and Wales and not at Scotland, and therefore they're not using that, and that we have a need for something to be very clear on that just now.
Okay, and Katie, anything to add to that?
Only that I think we are seeing inconsistency across different local authority areas, and that is a concern, because if you're presenting with in crisis and in need, then you should be able to get the help that you require, that no matter where you live. So I think that the points that that Morag and Kirsty have made about the clarity in the guidance and getting some minimum standards written into that guidance. That's not to say there should be no local flexibility, but it should be really clear what can be expected in no matter where you are in Scotland, and then where are the areas where we are more comfortable to see some variation in order to address perhaps local needs that might vary due to different demographics or something like that. So I think those are the points that I would want to reiterate. And I think just to again on DHPs, I would absolutely wholeheartedly agree with what both Kirsty and Morag said about DHPs. The guidance needs to be adjusted so that it's suitable for Scotland, and it is clear what the guidance in Scotland is. And I would absolutely urge that includes clarifying that DHPs can be used to provide targeted support with rent arrears, because I really do think we are going to be facing a wave of evictions later in 2021 if we don't get on top of this problem now.
That's helpful and very clear to get on the record, Katie. Just finally, the last last session also touched on, or two sessions ago, touched on the reduction in community care grants applications in the spring, and I think it was put down to fewer people moving tenancy. Plus, an issue was raised about the consistency of free school meals and holiday meals. Do any of the panel have anything they wish to say? Katie, have you got anything you would want to comment on those specifically?
Yeah, I mean, certainly on consistency around free school meals, it's something that the Commission looked at, and certainly we have urged, and we're really pleased to see the Scottish Government has is reiterating this, the focus on a sort of cash first approach. That is the way in which you can provide dignity to people, give them choices about the sort of food that is suitable for them and their family. So we're pleased to see that the Scottish Government is urging that, but we're still seeing a lot of variation in the way in which free school meals are being delivered by local authorities. Some of the choices are concerning, particularly, you know, in the past we've seen vouchers being used for just one particular supermarket, which may or may not be near to where you live. So, you know, there are lots of kind of, again, inconsistencies in the way in which local authorities are delivering this, that I think could, you know, there is a need to just sort of iron some of that out and just make sure that we are delivering what families need in a way that is quick and that is underpinned by those principles of dignity that are written into the Scottish system.
Okay, Kirsty, anything to add to that?
We would absolutely reiterate the support that it has to be cash first. We've had some sad tales through our advice line about people who were given vouchers who weren't able to spend them due to their circumstances. They might have been shielding or just unable to access the shops that they were available for. So it is absolutely imperative that the support is provided in cash. The thing that we would like to see is a minimum level of support consistent across Scotland, that local authorities have a minimum that they must pay in relation to the free school meal. Thank you.
Okay, and Morrig?
Sorry, I've got nothing to add to what's already been said.
Okay, thank you for that.
Okay, thanks, Shona. And Jeremy Balfour.
The panel, one of the advantages of coming last is that most of the questions have been covered. But I just want to and maybe start off with the Children's Roundtree Foundation, since it was your proposal, that the winter heating allowance to be extended to disabled adults as well as children. I suppose the question around that is, are we too late to do that? And how would you see that happening? And I suppose for the other two panels members, do you think that's a good idea?
We are really concerned about disabled adults. We completely understand the reasons why the disability assistance payments have been delayed. But you know, we feel like this is a group that has been cut adrift in a lot of the COVID response. So, you know, going into the pandemic, one in three disabled people in Scotland were in poverty. It's a group that's unjustly overlooked in the uplift that was applied to universal credit, because often, you know, a lot of people are still on legacy benefits, so they've missed out on that help. We know it's a group that's more likely to have been pushed out of work during the sort of the response to the pandemic as well. And it's also a group that struggled with additional costs throughout the lockdown, particularly around sort of support needs around help with caring, but also we've sort of heard lots of stories of people who have had real problems in sort of the way in which they would normally do their shopping. So, you know, it sort of piles problem on problem for the group of disabled adults in Scotland. And we think that, you know, the winter heating assistance for disabled children, that's a great policy. We're really glad that that's coming into being. And the question that we would ask is, you know, does this provide a mechanism that could be relatively straightforwardly tweaked in order to get cash into the pockets of disabled adults as well as disabled children, you know, prioritising those who are on the enhanced rate of PIF or the highest component of DLA. You know, the mechanism is there. We think it would potentially be quite simple to just change the eligibility a little to extend that bit of help to get a bit of cash in pockets of people that really need it and have really been on the sharp end of the impact of coronavirus, and a group that was already much more likely to be being held back by poverty.
Thank you. Katie, I mean, I should just say, probably declare an interest, but I would benefit from this if this happens, but just to clear that as an interest. But Katie, would you see this as a one-off because of the situation we're in at the moment, or do you think this should be something that should be happening long, you know, going forward? So we should just tweak it in such a way that all adults who are on the enhanced rate would get it going forward.
So I think certainly right now we're thinking about this as a crisis response, as a way, you know, mechanism that's there that we can use to help a group that has been overlooked unjustly in a lot of the help that's been made available. In the longer term, I think, you know, there are additional costs for disabled people around heating, often through the winter. So I think it is also worth looking at whether that should be a longer term part of the system as well. But right now, the thing that we're most concerned about is the crisis response.
Can I just check, do the other two panellists agree with that comment?
It's not something that we've looked into specifically, but we absolutely recognise that disabled people need an enhanced heating regime, and it seems like a sensible proposal. We've got a kind of longer term aim, which is to redesign the winter fuel payments, so they target people that are in fuel poverty, rather than being based on a kind of age demographic. But that's something that would involve collaboration with UK government, as my understanding is, that is a longer term game. So it sounds like GRF's proposal is a more kind of suitable short term proposal that would make a real difference to a group that have been particularly hard hit by the pandemic. And the other point that I would make in support of it is that CAS recognises the importance of well-heated homes in the kind of context of a pandemic that affects people's respiratory systems. So, yeah.
If I'm able to comment on that as well, please. We, CPAG, doesn't have a position on the winter heating allowance, but we do have concerns about disabled people being able to realise their entitlements that they should be getting at the moment. Particularly during the height of the pandemic, we noted that universal credit was being prioritised above everything else, at the expense of disability benefits being processed. So things that people who should be receiving additional amounts were being told that they couldn't have, assessments wouldn't be carried out, even if an assessment wasn't necessary, for example, somebody receiving chemotherapy, where it should just be an automatic decision that that person was entitled to an additional amount, those simply weren't being processed. And we're also seeing considerable delays in relation to personal independence payments. And that is sometimes leading to people's entitlements being stopped before the assessment's carried out. And they might then be entitled once the assessment is carried out, but in the meantime, there's a period of time where their income drops. So it's just to note our concern that we recognise that disabled people are facing difficulties realising their entitlements at the moment, even before we look at additional entitlements. Thanks.
Thank you, and that's helpful. Following on for that, obviously, we have, as we've heard, had a delay in regard to when we're going to be delivering DLA and PIP here in Scotland through the agency. But I just wondered, reflecting on the last 6 or 7 months, as we design the system, what are the things, are there any positives that we've learned out of this that can make it easier for people to either claim, or once they have claimed, for the process to work quicker? If anything that we've learned that we can use to streamline the system or anything like that as we go forward?
Okay, Katie, do you want to come in on that theme?
Yeah, if I could. I mean, one thing I would say is that I just think it's essential that as we do move forward and start to design these systems, it's about involving people who have experience of the system in those design choices. I mean, I think Social Security Scotland got off to a brilliant start by setting out its principles, working really closely with a group of people with lived experience and bringing that into how it sort of thought about what the system should look like. And I think that that way of working needs to be fed through into everything that it does. And because I think, you know, the best people to tell us what is, you know, what a good streamlined system would look like and how that would feel and how it would work is those who have, you know, who have firsthand experience of interacting with it. So I absolutely commend the Scottish Government for the choices that is made about the way in which it has involved people with lived experience, and would just urge that we continue in that vein in answering some of these questions.
Any other witness want to come in, make a comment on this theme?
Yeah, thank you. So to echo what Katie said about the kind of importance of co-production and listening to the experiences of people who are using the current system and the redesign, one thing that we would like to see done differently is a dramatically different approach to assessments, because we know that that causes distress for people and can actually put people off making an application for the payments as well. So we'd like to see that done dramatically differently in the new system. And I think that's something that Scottish Government have said that they will do, which is great. I think the kind of key to how that looks will come from working with voluntary sector organisations and with people with lived experience to identify what changes there should be. But one of the things we would like them to look at is the use of the mobility descriptors in the assessment process. And we also, along with CPAG and SCORES, have published a long-term vision for disability benefit in Scotland. And it sets out what we would like to see from the disability payment system beyond the current safe and secure transition. So we accept that that the kind of current process we're going through will bring effectively replicate the existing system while fixing some of the most problematic bits of it. And we think that that's a good approach in terms of ensuring stability and making sure that people continue to get the money that they need into their pockets. But over the longer term, we would like to see a full review of the system and how it operates, to make sure that the Scottish Government are realising their ambitions for a human rights-based approach to disability assistance. We'd like them to consider things like a whole-of-life benefit rather than the three separate payments for the different stages of people's lives. And we'd also like them to consider adopting a social model to disability payments rather than a medical one. So that's looking at focusing less on what is an individual able or not able to do and focusing more on what are the barriers to participation in society and how do we address those barriers.
Thank you, Morag. And just before we give Kirsty the opportunity to come in, Jeremy, do you have another question? Because time's getting tight, so you can maybe ask that question just now and roll it up together. I see you indicated.
No, sorry, I was meant to be a no, but I would have positive. I'm done after this. Thank you, Camina.
Okay. Kirsty, do you want to add anything to what we've heard?
No, I think I've nothing to add to what Morag's already said there. Thanks.
And can I just check if Alison Johnson, the MSP, wants to come in? She previously indicated on this theme, but I'm just wondering if Alison wants to come in.
I'm content, convener. I suppose, you know, my main concern is just, you know, lessons that those delivering benefits might learn in terms of not making applications unduly complicated and lengthy and, you know, just access to help people make a claim. And I think that point has been well made through the session, to be fair.
Okay. Alison, thank you for that. I suppose that also now allows me to thank our witnesses for a really productive evidence session. As Alison Johnson has just indicated, lots of key points have come up through the course of the session. So thank you to all of you. I know I'm saying please continue to follow the inquiry. I know you will anyway, because you always do. Your contribution is very, very valuable. But do get back in touch in relation to any other matters you think we should be covering or not, because that's invaluable to the committee as well. So can I thank our witnesses for our the evidence this morning, and we'll now move to agenda item three. So agenda item three is on subordinate legislation, and can I refer members to paper two, note by the clerk. Members are asked to consider the Carers Allowance Coronavirus Breaks in Care Scotland Amendment Regulation 2020, SSI 2020/350. It is subject to the negative procedure. Are members content to note the instrument? Now, I'll wait again for a brief moment in the chat box to ensure we get agreement on that. Otherwise, I'll say that we are content. Are members content? I see Rachel Hamilton indicating she wants to make a comment. Rachel?
Yeah, it was just to get clarification on the time with regards to this from the 3rd of December up until the 12th of May. And is that, had that been 6 months previously as well? Is this just a sort of a standard timing? That's my question.
I'm afraid that's not a question for me to answer, but that's a question we can seek clarity on. But I'm not sure if any other member wants to make an additional comment in relation to that, and whether your query or clarification prevents you from simply noting the instrument, but we can certainly get the clerk to give us clarity on that, Rachel.
Yes, please. And also, convener, that this was brought in to reflect the changes that the DWP had made, and I just would like a little bit more clarity on whether that is continuing with the UK government as well, just so that there is a consistency, that's all.
So I think that is my understanding, but as I say, it's not for myself to answer that question. It's for me to agree with you that if we need clarity, we should get that. But can I thank Rachel Hamilton for indicating that that doesn't prevent her from noting that she's content with the instrument. If there are any other comments, can we put them in the chat box just before we kind of formally note that? There are not. Thank you very much. We'll move to agenda item four, still on subordinate legislation. I can refer members to paper three, note by the clerk. Members are asked to consider the Social Security Personal Independence Payment Amendment Scotland Regulation 2020, SSI 2020/340, and it is again subject to negative procedure. Are members content to note this particular instrument, or would anyone like to make some comments just before we note it? That's Jeremy Balfour, of course. Yes.
Thank you, Commissioner. I mean, I have a couple of questions that perhaps we could just like discuss this comment on. I mean, I think firstly, I presume this has been implemented at Westminster, so the scheme will be the same across the whole of the United Kingdom, and I wasn't quite sure whether that was the case or not. And the second question is, I'm also presuming that there's been an equality impact of this, and I would be interested if we could write to Scottish Government to see that equality impact, because clearly, although it is a change, it does impact on older people. I'd be interested to know what work has been done in Scottish Government around that area of impact on older people.
Mr. Balfour, I think that's a reasonable point. Again, I think it is to ensure consistency in relation to quality impact. If we don't have that information already, let's see what additional information we can get from government. I think that's a reasonable point, but I don't see anyone indicating that they're not content to note the instrument. Again, I'll just give it a few seconds, give people opportunity to see otherwise in the chat box. Okay, that not been the case, then we will note that instrument. Thank you for your agreement. Okay, can I now formally close the public part of the meeting, but we now will move to agenda item five, where we'll reflect on the evidence we heard earlier in the meeting, and we'll do that on a different platform. So thank you, everyone, and we now move into private session.